Our school board meeting tonight. Thank you for being here. We have a quorum established, and I would like to ask Dr. Sonia Stewart to come lead us in the pledge, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Dr. Stewart. I would also like to take a moment to recognize Councilman Brett Withers is with us tonight. Welcome. You'll be...
That's right.
Your fan club over here. And tonight we have special guests with us. For the good news is we have Pearl Cone Entertainment Magnet High School students who are coming to share their stories with us tonight. So if all three of you would make your way up to the front here to the podium so you could enlighten us. And thank you for being with us tonight.
Hello, my name is Demetrius Pierres, and I am a senior at Pearl Cone, and I am in the Academy of Entertainment Communications. My pathway is audiovisual production, also known as broadcasting. What I like most about my pathway is, you know, we get to do hands-on work, and you know, we get a good feel of what we're doing. We get it good into our heads, and you know, it's very fun to be with the team, and you know, just go back and look at stuff that we've created, and you know, it's a real good honor. So,
guess I'm next. Hello, everyone. My name is Renisha Williams. I'm a senior at Pearl Cone Entertainment Magnet High School, and I'm in the Academy of Entertainment Management. My pathway is personal care and imaging, also known as cosmetology. And one thing I like about my pathway is that I'm able to apply everything that I learned in the classroom to my everyday life. And one interesting thing about my pathway is that we have encounters with celebrities such as Terry Hunt from the TV show L.A. Hair, I don't know if you've ever heard of it, as well as J.K. Hunter from Let's Make Up. And our pathway is just basically centered around all of us. Like, we work on each other, and we collaborate with other academies, you know, just makeup and, you know, like that. So... So what else we do in our in my pathway is we obtain hours, and those hours that we gain in the classroom can apply to us actually obtaining an actual cosmetology license if we choose to do so. And my post-secondary career option is to become a medical examiner, and although I'm in the Academy of Cosmetology and Personal Care, I can still apply those skills that I learned in that pathway to my career choice because of, like, the basic sciences that I learned, like, as far as basic chemistry, microbiology, and other complex and basic sciences that I learned throughout that, so.
Hello, everybody. My name is Vermonte Carpenter. I'm also a senior at Pearl Cone Entertainment High School. My pathway is recording industry, and my academy is Academy of Entertainment Management. I'm also the president of the record label, which I'm very glad to be a part of. One thing that we do and I love so much about our pathway is that it connects us and also connects us with our core classes that we have in our school, as well as, like I said, everyday like it's been said, everyday life. We had the opportunity to meet various artists such as Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis, BB and CC Winans. We also had the opportunity to write a welcome song for Dr. Joseph, welcoming him to Nashville. So, yeah, that's about it.
That was an awesome song.
He didn't get to. I was a little nervous, so I was kind of going fast. But this is just an award.
Award. So we have. Yeah.
Emmys, and we just recently received a national Emmy for work that one of our students did on a documentary, and we're very excited about it.
All right.
First time that I was a little nervous, so I really didn't get to mention much about my pathway and just the things that we do. But some of the projects that we work on, everything that we do is hands-on. We have partners with some of the things we do, but we are very good with using the resources, you know, and the tools that we have that we've been provided with for business partners and things like that. So we make documentaries and you know, short movies and things that we are interested in taking a long way. And one of my classmates, his name is Liz, and he came here a few years ago. You know, I don't want to get it wrong where he's from.
From Afghanistan.
Afghanistan, okay. So he's from Afghanistan, and, you know, he didn't have a choice. He had to come here. So he had a hard time, you know, with the language and different things like that, but he's came, and we filmed a documentary with him, and, you know, why he's here.
Thank you, students. You did a great job. And thank you, Dr. Stewart, for being here, and for Ms. Jackson, the academy coach. Thank you very much for being here tonight. Before we get into the consent agenda, I am going to move item F off the consent agenda so we can have discussion about it on the board floor. So with that being said, Ms. Spearing?
Thank you. The consent agenda reads as follows. 1A, approval of minutes from board meetings 3-29-16, 4-19-2016, 5-3-2016, 5-6-2016, 5-13-2016, 5-24-2016, that's a lot of meetings, 6-28-16. B, recommended award of contract for professional services, program management services, Heary International, Inc. C, recommended approval of change order number 1 for Cambridge Early Learning Center's Center additions and renovations, Dowdle Construction Group, LLC. D, recommended approval of change order number 3 for Glenview Elementary School additions and renovations, Bomar Construction Company, Inc. E, awarding of purchases and contracts, 1, for the Arbinger Institute, LLC, 2, Exxon Americas, 3, Lipscomb University. 4, REA Controls. D, Legal Settlement Claim Number C-34200 for the sum of $3,217. This concludes the consent agenda, Madam Chair. I move to approve the consent agenda as read.
Any second?
Second.
All in favor? Show of hands. Opposed? Thank you. Ms. Harkey, if you could come to the podium, please, and we'll talk about item two. No, it's item two.
So the item that has been removed and that we're discussing now is the collaborative conferencing. As you know, at the last meeting, Eric Huth was here on behalf of the MNEA, and he submitted a box of names. That is the starting point to initiate a collaborative conferencing, specifically the TCA provision that spells this out, and what I'll be talking about kind of and what you guys are here to do today is TCA 495605. The first step to start that collaborative conferencing is the submission of names by an organization during October 1 to November 1. Obviously, that's what Eric Huth did last week. I think our HR department is currently reviewing those names to make sure that they meet the requirements of professional employees. What is coming before you tonight is the first, after we receive those names and after they've been confirmed, the next step in the process is for the Board of Education to appoint a special question committee. Again, pursuant to the TCA provision, it states that the Board of Education shall appoint an equal number of its professional employees and board members to serve on a special question committee for the purpose of conducting a confidential poll of all eligible professional employees as provided in the subdivision below. So again, that's what we're here to do tonight, is that the Board of Education is being asked to appoint both an equal number of board members as well as professional employees. I believe that Anna had already suggested and spoken with two board members in terms of maybe a suggestion for having two board members and then two professional employees. I believe administration has come up with at least some recommendations so that you know, having 9 members try to discuss professional employees. I know they reached out to MNEA and who has suggested one of the professional employees, and then they have another one as well for your consideration. So I'll have Jana mention those names, or do you want me to? Okay, I think the MNEA representative was Amanda Kale. She's a teacher at Margaret Allen Middle School. And then the other one is
Tuana
TJ Williams, from, she's an automotive teacher at Maplewood High School. So those, again, are the two professional employees' recommendations. Anna, if you have suggestions for the board in terms
of... Sure. I reached out to my colleagues, Amy Frogue and Will Pinkston, and they agreed to serve on the special committee. So those are the 4 names that we have to vote on tonight. And it is your recommendation that we take a vote?
Yes, it is my recommendation that you go ahead and take a vote. Again, the law says that the Board of Education will appoint these equal number of board members and professional employees, so I would ask that you make a motion and take a vote on those 4.
Can I get someone to make a motion? Well, then I'll make a motion. I would like to move that we nominate as board reps Amy Frogue and Will Pinkston, and as the professional reps Amanda Kale and TJ Williams for the special question committee with the collaborative conferencing. If I could get a second.
Second.
Okay, could I have a show of hands, all in favor? Oh, I'm sorry, discussion. Any discussion?
I'm sure you've said this. Can you explain to me slowly what actually this committee does?
So yes, the short answer is that they are conducted for the purpose of conducting a confidential poll of all eligible professional employees, as provided in the rest of the section. The rest of the section goes into great detail about actually sending out a survey to all professional employees in the district, having them answer certain questions, and the TCA more or less even outlines what those questions need to be. Okay. Specifically, what we're looking for is whether or not people want to be represented in collaborative conferencing, and if yes, then they would say who they would like to have represent them, whether it be MNEA, unaffiliated, and then if they are not interested in participating in collaborative conferencing, they're still kind of asked who might they want to represent them should collaborative conferencing occur. And again, there are check boxes. part of the job of the committee will be kind of making sure that the survey reads correctly, but also kind of coming up with a plan on how to send the survey out to ensure that all professional employees have an opportunity to respond to that survey. The result of that survey will then tell us whether or not, if a majority of people respond yes to the first question that they do want collaborative conferencing, then again, if that majority says yes, then we would move to the next steps of actually going through a collaborative conferencing process. Is that
any other? We have another question.
And the collaborative conferencing process is that what you're looking for? Yeah, it's basically is the opportunity to come together with the district, with members of the board, with and the director to discuss very specific issues that are outlined in the TCA that could then be put into a memorandum of understanding.
Okay, so if in the event, so we, okay, let's say we, the results say we want collaborative conferencing is desired, they would come before the entire board?
No.
Help me understand who, so we get to the point where now yeah, we've got it, and they have an issue to come before the, before who? Who does it come
before? I don't have that TCA provision pulled up. But, second, I want to make sure I want to make sure I give you the exact language from the
me
TCA.
Too.
I apologize. I spent so much time getting the special question survey down. So. So if they want, the term of the member. So then, if the majority comes in, then the board will then be asked to appoint members to a panel, and the panel would meet. And again, let me make sure the term of the members of the panel will consider first question in 3 years. So then. The special question committee, so if enough people say yes that they want collaborative conferencing, then you look to who would make up the people that would be offered the spot at the table from the professional employees. So if 15% or more of a certain group say that they want to be represented by a certain group, then they would be one of the members, they would be like that organization that constitutes a portion of that collaborative conferencing. The panel, I'm not making a lot of sense, but the special question committee should appoint or shall select and appoint a person or persons to serve as an unaffiliated representative. Sorry, the term of the members of the panel. You would select a panel. Why am I not finding the right spot?
So what we're voting on right now, these four names are the special questions committee.
Correct.
And these then, four people would then appoint a panel to hear a grievance with representation from whomever represents the 15%.
Correct. Upon receiving the results of the poll in which the majority of those eligible to vote respond yes to the first question, so if they've wanted the collaborative conferencing, the Board of Education shall appoint at least 7, but no more than 11 persons to serve as management personnel. The professional employees shall be entitled to the same number of representatives as the number of the management personnel selected by the Board of Education. So, if we go through the survey and a majority of people want collaborative conferencing, and it would come back to the board for the board to appoint at least 7, but no more than 11 persons to serve as management personnel.
Where does people come from? They're selecting them from the board members, from administration?
From the definition of management personnel. Which I will have to go look at the very specific
today,
definition.
But it's not us.
But that's the idea. It's not going to be
us.
You. It's going to be personnel within MNPS, management personnel.
Gotcha.
So you would accept 7 to 11, and then the whichever organizations meet their threshold requirement to serve on this panel as well, they would have an opportunity to appoint the right proportion of people to serve on that panel as well.
So, last question. So the duties of the four individuals that we're asking to approve today is simply to administer the survey
get the results, and then report it back out.
Correct. Yes. Sorry. Yes.
Here's has a question.
So the cards that were presented last month just said that they want this to go on the ballot. Is this correct?
Correct.
Okay. So, but say it all passes. This really does not change much since 2011. I mean, this provision has been in place. Last superintendent had ongoing open conferencing with MNEA. It doesn't really change what?
So my understanding, since this TCA provision was adopted in 2011,
right.
So it's been on the books in 2011. It is my understanding that this is the first time that MNEA or any organization, and please, Chris, that any organization has actually met the initial requirement to submit the submission of 15% or more of the professional employees in a group. So
right.
This is the first time that an organization has actually submitted those names to even take this to a collaborative conferencing that is spelled out in this TCA.
Right. I just have had some teachers ask if they, if this is being more or less used to try to draw in more members, does this change MNEA's kind of power position since the collective bargaining was done away in 2011? And my understanding is no, but this provision has been in place. It's just having the director collaborate and have conferencing with the MNEA, like Dr. Register did.
This provision has certainly been in place since 2011. This is the first time
okay.
that MNEA has submitted the names, but, you know, there was an informal process.
Gotcha.
Mr. Benson?
Yeah, I mean, just to kind of level set and go back through the recent history on this, in 2011, the legislature in its wisdom torpedoed collective bargaining and replaced it with this collaborative conferencing, which is basically a series of hurdles, in my view, to require employee representation organizations to jump through over hurdles and through hoops in order to get back close to the same point that they were at the time of collective bargaining. So this is just getting back to where we were, but just a lot more obstacles in the way in order to do it. Ms. Harkey, is there, or maybe MNEA has this, is there kind of a collaborative conferencing 101 document that we could get that sort of explains the process so that we all are starting on the same page?
Certainly I can provide the TCA provisions that are relevant, certainly can provide that to the board. Also, in 49-5601, there is reference to TOSS, the Tennessee Organization of School Superintendents. They have been asked to do a training. This was all the way back kind of at the initial stand when this came into existence, when this was adopted by the legislature. And so I know that TOSS does have a training. In fact, we've been working on trying to see if we can get an updated version of that training since it has been a while since it's been provided here in Davidson County.
So even like a one- or two-page overview would be useful, I think, you know, for the board and then also to transmit to the public for their view as well.
Sure, I can even create that for you.
The comptroller did a report March 2012 that kind of lays out the differences. It's pretty easy. It's a little longer than two pages, but I'm happy to send you the link.
Dr. Branham.
So what's the process that has to take place with the names that were submitted?
So tonight, the board is just being asked to vote on those names. Again, tonight, we're just setting up the special question committee.
Box of names.
So the names themselves, I think, are Amy Frogue and Will Pinkston as board members. No, that's not what you were looking for.
The names that were sent in a box were just enough to get us to have to vote on it tonight.
Yes, that was to try to get to the 15%. That's MNEA's submission of 1,400 names, signature cards, to meet the 15% threshold that starts the collaborative conferencing process. So again, the first part of this whole thing is that an organization that's interested in collaborative conferencing has to submit showing that 15% of the professional employees in the LEA are interested in collaborative conferencing.
I thought I heard someone say something about the names being gone, they have to go through a process.
So HR is currently just checking those names to make sure, in fact, that the 1,400 names are, in fact, names of teachers or professional employees that work in the district.
They've already verified.
I'm hearing that right now.
Does anybody else have any other questions or concerns that they want to ask Mr. Harkey? Okay. Since we've had a discussion, we can now have a vote. I would like a show of hands to approve the four names that were nominated tonight, Amanda Kale and TJ Williams, and then from the board, Amy Frog and Will Pinkston. All in favor? Any opposed? Thank you all. I appreciate that. All righty. Now moving on to item number now three, Mr. Pinkston.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So this is the charter facility policy proposal that we discussed in governance committee and passed at a governance committee a couple of weeks ago. After talking this around with Dr. Joseph and Dr. Carlisle, I'd like to defer discussion of this proposed policy until at least the next board meeting. The more I thought about it, the more it dawned on me that we risk falling into the same trap that we have fallen into in the past, which is trying to deal with a complex issue with a piecemeal approach. I think we definitely need a charter facility policy, but I also think it's time to have the big hairy conversation that we've all been dreading, which is, do we or do we not want a moratorium on charter growth? Earlier this month, the NAACP took the courageous step of articulating why a moratorium is needed nationally. I think the next logical step is for local school boards around the country to follow in the discussion. As Dr. Gentry said at our recent board retreat, we need to make some space for the inevitable noise that will come with this debate, and I think we just need to make it as confined as possible so that we don't get into this endless loop Groundhog Day discussion that we've had in the past. So I'd like to just request that we schedule a block of time next month on the board floor to have this conversation about a moratorium, a facility policy, litigation, and anything else that folks might want to put on the table. Just have the debate, cast our votes, and then move on to more important issues. And again, keep it confined and not a long, drawn-out discussion. So with that, I'd like to defer. I don't know if that requires a motion and a vote or not, but if that's allowable, defer to a future date and then just have one big conversation and get it over with.
Okay. Anybody else have anyone?
I would just request that we allow some public comment before we have any sort of decision, have it more out in the open.
Okay. All right. Anybody else have any? I just think it's a wise decision to defer and do this well.
Yes. I would agree. Thank you, Mr. Pinkston, for that. All right, we're moving on to reports. Dr. Jeff? Do we have to make a motion? All right, so can I get a motion for deferring?
I'd like to make a motion to defer the proposed policy revision to EE 17.
Second.
All in favor? Show of hands. Any discussion? Okay. All in favor? Show of hands. Thank you. Appreciate that. All right, now moving on to Dr. Jeff.
Okay. I think we have a PowerPoint. I still appreciate it.
Apologize for that.
Did you get new glasses?
I did. I can see. I was blind, but now I can see.
He's seen and he's still here, so yay.
Whole new world out there.
Find those notes I put on the bottom of your contract. No, I'm just kidding.
Okay, thank you. So this is just a 100-day update, and I think last time we talked, I said I would share just more specifics, kind of framing what the work has been in the first 100 days, particularly around leadership and so forth. But it all begins with a theory of action, and I remember when I interviewed, I talked about the fact that, great systems work from frameworks. And if we're going to really move the needle on student achievement, that we needed to work from a theory of action that was compelling and kind of focused what our work was. So as we move to the next slide, we discussed, and it's pretty simple, and a theory of action should be strong enough that people, even if we didn't say it, people should say, well, let's think about what they're doing, and we can guess what that theory of action is. And ours simply says that if we focus on building principals, teachers, coaches, and central office staff's leadership capacity to improve school culture and ensure high-quality literacy instruction, then we will have outstanding academic achievement for all children. So the keys there are, you know, so we're going to do something about culture. We're going to be intentional about our literacy work, and we're going to be intentional about the leadership work that has to happen. Next slide. Yeah, so in essence, we need to focus on student achievement, and if we're going to ensure that all students are achieving at high levels, we need to make sure we have, you know, coherent structures, frameworks, practices, and expectations that are throughout the school district, that we're developing the capacity of teachers and leaders, that we're building a positive school culture and building a strong district culture, that we're facilitating positive change in practice and behavior, and we're developing and delivering rigorous and rich curriculum, particularly in the area of literacy. So, as you know, we've talked about this a lot. Our data, you know, compels us to act. And as we look at 39% of our students being proficient in reading and in the eighth grade, as we look at 41% of our students performing, you know, we have work to do. So, in terms of our first 100 days, you know, we've been intentional about, we've got to build an infrastructure to do this work. You know, it's dangerous to start down the course of tackling tough problems without first establishing the infrastructure to tackle those problems. If you don't have the right leadership and you just run off and try to solve problems, you put yourself in jeopardy of getting a lot of pushback and the initiatives failing. And then one of the things we said our kids can't afford is for us not to execute well and get better outcomes. So we've started thinking about, so how do we address the mindsets of our district, you know, just getting us in the right frame of mind to tackle the work more aggressively, but doing it in a way where we work with people and people don't feel like the work is coming from the top down, but it's really coming from the bottom up. You know, how do we think about influencing behaviors, right? And you know, we have to model the way. And we've talked a lot about that, and I appreciate the collaboration of the board as we've been modeling how we should do business with a sense of urgency, a sense of focus, but with a sense of listening and understanding. You know, we're identifying strengths and thinking about, you know, we recognize all employees, all students have strengths, but we have to bring those strengths to the front and really work with all to put people in positions of strength so we can get the best out of everyone. We have to think about how we're coaching people intentionally. And we also have to think about, you know, instructional coherence. Prior to this meeting, we had a teaching and learning meeting. And one of the themes that kept coming through that meeting was alignment. That you know, as we are working with a multitude of different groups within the school district, how do they all hear the same message, get the same thing, so that way when we're executing, people aren't confused about what our strategy is. And we have to continue changing practices. I mean, there's some things that we're doing that we probably need to stop doing, and there are things that we need to start doing, but we have to have those conversations about what's working and what evidence do we have that it is working, and if it's not working, how do we reappropriate to those things that work? So as we think about the work that we've been doing, I know there's been lots of questions about, you know, who we're partnering with and kind of what the strategy is, and we wanted to just make a little more coherent what this work is. So again, this is connected to our theory of action, which says we've got to focus on, you know, culture and literacy and leadership development to improve academic achievement for all. And these first 100 days, as we have been spending lots of time listening, assessing where we are, we recognized one thing we couldn't wait on was getting our leadership structures in place and beginning to put those structures in place to move forward. So in the area of literacy, as, again, from the Teaching and Learning Committee earlier today, we discussed the fact that we've been working with Scholastic Education to help us with our guided reading. I mean, they're doing some of the best work in the country. Lipscomb University, we've continued that partnership, and you know, they're doing extraordinary work supporting our elementary teachers. We entered into a partnership with Learning Forward, which is they're kind of like the gold standard of professional development in the nation for professional development. And we are very fortunate to be in a collaborative with about, I think, 18 or 20 other school districts from around the country, Memphis, Knox County, Loudoun County, from Tennessee are also a part of that national collaborative to look at how do we scale professional development coherently within the district. And also, we're using some leadership standards here to frame our work. But as we thought about organizational culture, you've been introduced to Arbinger, and we have been speaking about how we scale that work. We've been working with Gallup, and Moravia is a organization that helps with coaching. So as we have the principals and we're teaching the principals how to work from their strengths, we needed support with the executive lead principals, teaching them how to coach on strengths. And with leadership development, we have been working with SCORE. So we have a team of teachers who are doing work with them, and a number of, we've have some great universities here within the region, and so we're working with Vanderbilt and Tennessee State to help think through our leadership framework. We're also working with TNTP, is a company that helps provide technical support with leadership development and other things. We have some grant monies that we are. I've received an I-3 grant to help support innovation that we've been utilizing with our leadership work. And again, the same standards are framed around that work. Last time when we met, when we talked about the L5 work, you saw the standards in that that little diagram that we had given you on that. And then as it relates to governance, we've been working with the Arbinger Institute again, the Panasonic Foundation. As you know, we're going to be working with Panasonic this week to continue the work that we have started as we think about framing what it is that we need to do moving forward in developing a strategic plan and executing on our work. And also, IntraQuest was just the group that we worked with as we got the strength reports. That was the company that provided that to us. So as we think about this year with the literacy work, that's impacting all elementary educators within the district, our executive officers, our executive lead principals, and our principals in our priority schools. As we think about the organizational culture work, it's affecting all central office staff, our executive officers, our executive lead principals, our directors and our directors' direct reports. This year, the leadership development work, we're going to identify specific teachers that we're working with, selected certified staff who are aspiring leaders. Our big piece is making sure this year we establish a pipeline of future leaders, and we have some thoughtful training with them. And then our governance work, it's working with us and our direct reports. But we wanted to give you this visual just so you can see where we're going this year and the next year. Some of that work expands into other areas. So again, why invest in school leaders? Again, the research is very clear that leadership is second only to teaching among school-related factors that impact student learning. So, we recognize if we don't have strong leaders and build a foundation for leaders, as we develop an aggressive strategic plan, there's no way to execute on it effectively. We don't have the people to help us spearhead that work. So that's why in these first 100 days, there's been intentional thought around building capacity of leaders. As you know, my dissertation won the American Educational Research Association's Dissertation of the Year for leadership development. So it's an area I'm kind of comfortable swimming in terms of thinking about the hows and whys on this piece. But it's essential that we get that foundation before we go ahead and move. Next slide, please. And And we've spent a lot of time on the culture piece because, you know, we have thousands of employees, and we have 89,000 children, and we want to make sure that the environment in which we work is appropriate. I mean, we want to make sure because we're pushing hard. I mean, these first 100 days, I fully accept the criticism that maybe anxiety has gone up a little bit because we're pushing, and it's new and it's different. But as we push, we're being thoughtful about how we push. I mean, we want to drive, but we don't want to drive people crazy. And so investing in organizational support and thinking about the how we feel is important. And we'll continue to do that work and listen and pressure check. I mean, you want to push, like I said, because our kids deserve us to push, and our data compels us to act with a sense of urgency. But we will continue to be mindful about the how, because we believe that's equally important. And that just concludes that 100-day update. In terms of outcomes from the last time, over the last 2 weeks, we haven't completed any additional work. We still have, I believe, 18 days before the 100 days are up. So maybe two more board meetings. We'll present the findings from the four committees at that time and just let us know the status check. And that concludes my report. I'll open it up for questions.
Does anybody have any questions or comments? Can't believe. Okay, Ms. Frog.
So on the groups that are working with us on specific areas, what probably differs according to the area, but what is the role of these groups? Is this a conversation that we're having? Are they providing grants? Are they providing research? You had sort of a varied group. I was looking at leadership and development pipeline.
Yeah, can we put this slide back up, please? And go back to the slide that had the different buckets of work. Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. So I'm just wondering what role these organizations are playing in.
Yeah, I would say. So with all of them, our strategy has always been we bring in the best-in-class expertise to help build our capacity for us to be able to do it on our own. So, for example, I'll take, let's take Arbinger. And Arbinger is coming. Many board members and a number of our staff, for example, went and we got certified to train people in the Arbinger work. So that way we don't need to rely on them and paying consultants time and time again. We've invested in ourselves, and now we can come back and we can train people. The same thing is happening with the Scholastic. You know, they're teaching us on the train-to-trainer model on how to implement the guided reading work, for example. So then once they've shown us how to do it and we're trained and they feel like we can do it well, they can kind of disappear, and then we can continue that work going through as we go through. But if you have a specific question.
I guess I was really looking at the leadership development and pipeline. Yeah. That's a kind of varied group that we have working together.
Yeah, so we've sat down with a number of local universities to look at, it's twofold. One, we've got to create a pipeline. Just today, we were in our my cabinet meeting, and we said, for example, we know we have 18 people who are in the, I think the principal pipeline right now. If we had to hire a principal right now, we know we have 18 people who have been vetted through our system. That's not a lot when you have 100 some odd schools. And we hope, so we're thankful for Dr. Stewart and others who are happily working, and don't leave us no time soon because we need you. But we recognize we want to have a healthier pipeline. So we are talking about what that pipeline looks like, and we're working with local universities to help actually design a training for sitting principals as we think about delivering. But we need to look at our assistant principals and others, people who are certified, to give them training so we feel that they're ready to be in. But that work is not done. Right now we're in the stages where we've just kind of laid out a leadership framework, and they're working on that framework to help us design the details because we want a solid curriculum. So we've been working with the state on this because they have a governor's academy. So we've been looking at what's involved there. Dr. Narcisse, in his last job, was very active with the Wallace Foundation, who's been doing national work on leadership development. So he's been consulting with them and getting some insight and expertise, you know, on what our design will be. But these are the folks that will help us with the local, you know, implementation. You know, so we want to work closely with the universities twofold. One, you know, I mean, they are currently involved in the research and so forth. But more importantly, if we can help influence their programs now while people are going through firsthand, it benefits us in terms of the additional support we have to give them once they're out.
And I'll just say, as a board member, I can't speak to all the work that's being done, but. The work that we have done with Arbinger and are currently doing with Panasonic has really been invaluable. I think we all agree that we are moving forward leaps and bounds. So I'm appreciative of that opportunity for us to all begin to work more collaboratively together.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, I have a question and a comment, I guess. So I appreciate you reaching out to the universities. I will say this, Vanderbilt had a program at one time that helped me get my second master's because it was designed specifically for MNPS teachers. Have you considered anything like that, partnering with the university to help support staff members? Because you see paraprofessionals all the time who want a bachelor's or a master's or a higher ed degree. Could we consider that?
We have, and Ms. Story has been actively working with a number of university partners that we've done our rounds speaking with them and talking about opportunities in different areas. So we have different universities supporting us with different aspects of the work. But we are, one of the things we recently talked about was how do we, particularly as we're thinking about identifying, you know, high quality, diverse staff that look like our students, you know, the first place to look is within the organization, you know, people who are our paraeducators, you know, our bus drivers, our secretarial staff, what opportunities do we have? So we've been talking about that with partners. And then there have been a number of engaged conversations that I've been in, but I know since Ms. Story has been on board, she has been actively speaking with them as well.
Anybody else?
And I would like to echo Ms. Folks' comments and say how much we do appreciate individually and as a board the professional development that we have had, well, since June and continuing this weekend. It's like nothing that we've ever done before, so, and I really think it's really helped us speak as one team. Okay, nobody have any questions? Okay.
I just want to say one thing.
Okay.
We're building a better board. Yay!
All right, we'll move on to board chair's report, and I'm going to let my colleague Jill Sparing go first.
All right, if you knew that academic performance could be improved, that tardiness and absenteeism would decrease, that depression symptoms, substance abuse, and even caffeine consumption decline, would you be interested in furthering this discussion? Research is at the University of Minnesota wrote a report in 2014 called Examining the Impact of Later High School Start Times on the Health and Academic Performance of High School Students. It was a result of a three-year project looking at data from 9,000 students in 8 high schools in 3 states. And at one particular school, motor vehicle crashes involving teenagers decreased by 70%. When they changed the start time to 8:55. That's remarkable, isn't it? Research is clear that starting high school at 7 a.m. is counterproductive to the biological clock of teenagers. According to the National Sleep Foundation, a chronic health problem among teens is sleep deprivation. Although teenagers need approximately 9.25 hours of sleep per night for optimal performance, they actually average only about 7 hours per school night. Evidence suggests that teens' natural time to fall asleep may be 11 or even later. And when adolescents start school at 7 a.m., they cannot get the required amount of sleep that they need for their health and for their brain development. Districts that have made this change immediately noticed a gain in student achievement just by the sheer fact that they're asleep during their first period. Our board and community may want to consider the unintended consequences of a 7:05 start time and problem solve with administration how to change policy to best meet the needs of our adolescents. This topic is of interest to me, as well as Ann Christian, who spoke on high school start times at public participation on September the 13th. I bring this up tonight to ask if you would like to pursue this topic as well, to ask Dr. Joseph and his team to investigate how other districts have made this change, as well as the fiscal impact that it would require.
I'll open the floor for discussion, comments. Ms. Fogg.
So I'm just going to echo some of her comments from a different perspective. The American Academy of Pediatrics made a pretty bold statement a couple of years ago recommending that we aim for start times that allow students to receive 8.5 to 9.5 hours of sleep a night. In most cases, this would mean a school start time of 8:30 a.m. or later. And again, as Ms. Spearing already pointed out, studies show that adolescents who don't get enough sleep suffer physical and mental health problems and increased risk of automobile accidents and a decline in academic performance. The research is clear. I'm reading from comments on the American Academy of Pediatrics. The research is clear that adolescents who get enough sleep have a reduced risk of being overweight or suffering depression, are less likely to be involved in automobile accidents and have better grades, higher standardized test scores, and an overall better quality of life. And so the pediatricians have concluded that chronic sleep loss in children and adolescents is one of the most common and easily fixable public health issues in the U.S. today. So it seems to me if we have the American Academy of Pediatrics making a clear recommendation as to what's best for students, that's certainly something we should consider. I know this is a really hot topic out in my area, probably will be across the city. You know, one of the concerns that I've heard is that many of the parents use the older children kind of help babysit the younger children when they come home. So I think that any discussion of changing start times might include an effort to offer more enrichment activities after school, where children could stay after school and have really positive experiences like they have at the Nashville After Zone Alliance, NASA program. And I also recognize that this is, you know, something that it's going to take a lot of work to reschedule buses and make a district-wide change, but I think it's certainly something that we really should do for our children, because we know that it will help them do better in life and it will also help them perform better in school.
So. Any other comments? Go for it.
So I know it's really difficult to disagree with the American Academy of Pediatrics.
But I'm going to do it anyway.
However, in my district, I live in Antioch, and I can't imagine safety having that many more teenage children driving in that district, because traffic, especially around 8 o'clock, 8:30 a.m. in the morning, traffic is already a mess. And just if you think about the city of Nashville on a whole, traffic is just, it's horrible. And to put that many people, more people on the road at that time during the day, I think it would just be a disaster for the city of Nashville. And just speaking personally, my senior just graduated from high school last year, and I just think when he wakes up earlier, he goes to bed earlier. So that's my own personal opinion, and that's all.
Anybody else have anything they want to say? Dr. Brandon?
I'm concerned as to how this will impact the extracurricular activities that the students participate in after school. And so you're right, a lot will have to be looked at as we consider this proposal.
It's definitely not an overnight fix, and I can just imagine some band directors I know and some coaches I know who, if they're listening, their heads are spinning because they use that time after school for practice and rehearsal and things like that. And also, another thing that we might want to consider is that in a district such as ours, we have a lot of high school students who work after school, and a lot of times they have to work after school. It's not because they want to have some pocket money. It's because they're actually, you know, helping mom and dad. So, I mean, it's going to be so multifaceted. It's just not an easy fix. So, you know, I think I spoke with Dr. Carlisle, and she said that there was a possibility of having an intern do some research around this particular topic. So if that is something that you're comfortable with, Dr. Joseph. Okay. Mr. Kingston.
Yeah, just listening to Ms. Spearing and Ms. Frogue lay out the case, the research-based case. I now understand why I fell asleep in trig at Overton High School back in the day. It wasn't just because it was boring math. So as somebody who has kind of suffered through in a previous life early start times in the school system, and as somebody who's dealing with it now as the parent of a 15-year-old in an MNPS school, we're struggle every day. I think that that it's worth looking at. I think for all the reasons that Ms. Hunter and Dr. Brannon have talked about, it's important to move, you know, very carefully around it because it has so many, it's kind of like throwing a pebble in a pond, and it creates so many other ripples that affect so many other things, including, you know, parents being able to get to work on time and, you know, everything else that we talked about. But I think it's worth considering. I'd love Dr. Joseph to hear what you think the next steps would be to, you know, looking at this intentionally, rationally, systematically, and, you know, how that process could work.
Yeah, it's a big topic, and it's one that has lots of implications, as we all said. I think, you know, step one, I think we can, if Dr. Carlisle has an intern who's available, who can at least bring to us just the general pros and cons and what's out there in a more kind of formalized process, I think we could look at that. And then I think after that presentation of just kind of what's out there and who's done it, if the board is still interested in that, I think we would need to put together a committee. And I think that committee would be comprised of some parents and some staff. I think we would need to get some of our government agencies involved, because when you have a change of that magnitude, as was shared, it could affect the entire city. And I think that would be, it would be wise for us if we wanted to pursue to get that perspective there, because that decision will impact everybody. And then look at the fiscal cost. I mean, you know, and I think, you know, right now, it's sometimes there's this writer out there, John Maxwell, and he's written this book called The 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership and lots of other things. And he has this law of timing. That he says, you know, sometimes you have a great idea, but the timing of it just might not be the best. And my initial response is, as we're thinking about building a strategic plan and getting some coherence, is the timing for such a large, complex decision right? And I don't have the answer right now. It's just that immediately struck me as I'm sitting here thinking about the work. And I worked in a school district for 16 years that spent about 2 years looking at this issue. So I know it's a complex issue, and I think they actually did decide to move forward with it after a 2 years of looking and collaboration and conversation. So I would say, you know, if that's something we did decide to do, I'm fine with working towards that. I just know it's a process. And people would just have to understand that it's a process, because the nuances, and, you know, we've got to weigh the cost benefit of it all, and, you know, and then see where we end up. So step one, if we want to move forward, I can make sure we have a team to begin researching just the pros and cons, and we can set up identify a timeline for that work to be completed. And put it on our board calendar. And one of the things we're talking about right now is establishing our board agenda and so forth. So as a part of that process, we can lay out when we anticipate a initial presentation could be set for the board as a first step.
Anybody else have any comments?
to say that we set our priority as around literacy, and to me, at this time, it would be a distraction. We have a lot that we're trying to do in terms of achievement for students, and I listened to your what the pediatrics report said, but on the other hand, to me, it would be a distraction and take us away from our goal, our immediate goal.
That's it.
Also, anybody else?
Yeah, I just want to follow up with Dr. Joseph about that, because I certainly don't want this to be a distraction to the work in front of us. Is this something that the research team or this assistant could begin? And like you said, if it takes 2 years with the work ahead, would that be a distraction? Would that take away from our goal of literacy and culture and improving academic?
You know, I don't think step one, just the initial, kind of scan of the research and bringing it back more formalized, looking at districts. I'm particularly interested in districts that are as large as us, seeing how it's much easier in a smaller district where you don't have that impact. But you're talking about 89,000 children and, thousands of high schoolers, and that's who, I think just the initial scan, I don't think, would be much. The actual work of implementation would be. Mm-hmm. If we decided to move forward, then I think there's a lot involved, and then we'd have to weigh that.
I just wanted to say thank you for your thoughtful approach to this, and I agree, not wanting to get us off course, but as having teenagers who have lived through this, that extra hour of sleep can make a huge difference, even on literacy and understanding once you get to school and you're just more alert and rested. So I do think the timing, I just appreciate the thoughtfulness, but do hope that we could use intern to start putting the pieces together.
And I know this goes without saying, and I know you made the comment about making sure we're looking at districts that are our size, but we also need to look at the diversity. In a district that's 74% poverty, there's not always the eagerness to walk out of your house and leave a teenager at home for another hour alone, because we do have parents that work. And I think this is probably going to be that one of those topics that starts to highlight the diversity of the districts that we represent, because the impact to the district as a whole may show one thing, but when you start to break down that impact by district, by geography, by socioeconomic status, the different geographic parts of the city, that decision of that 1 hour may mean more than a high-level assessment, and there will be a step two and a step three that gets us to a 2 to 3 year discussion about an implementation plan. So I just want to make sure that this doesn't become the thing that we push on, given all the other things that are on our plate right now, because I will tell you that getting a child out of bed an hour later will improve literacy only if we have great literacy going on and great literacy efforts in place. And so let's just ensure that we keep our eyes on the foundational things that we're trying to establish within this district. The culture has to be adjusted for some people to even be open to having this discussion. So we've got work going on in some very fundamental and foundational areas that if we have an intern that can do this kind of a literature review or a scan of the atmosphere, the environment, to see where this has happened, districts this size, district with this diversity, and the other complex issues that we have to work with here in Nashville, I think that's great. I would definitely not push you all to do something that takes resources that are working on things right now that we as a board have already determined to be important, that are part of the 100-day plan, a part of the strategic work that needs to happen. If it has to take away from that, I think we need to put that where it appropriately needs to sit on a priority list.
Anybody else have any comments? Thank you. I have a very short board report. Almost 2 weeks ago now, we as a board participated in a retreat with Dr. Joseph and his chiefs, facilitated by the Panasonic Foundation. There was a unanimous agreement to move in a common direction, or as my colleague Mr. Pinkson likes to say, rowing in the same direction. And I like that description because it is very descriptive, because one can almost see us rowing a boat together, and we really are. We are rowing a boat called Metro Nashville Public Schools, and it's a huge ship. It's not really a boat at all. We are rowing in the direction of building a new and better board. We are professionalizing our operations, functions, and governance, and we are streamlining our committee structure. Because at the end of this rowing trip, we want to see a quality world-class education for our 89,000 students and as a culmination of our rowing efforts. We as board members are rowing with Dr. Joseph and his team to improve the district, and we are committed to supporting Dr. Joseph and his team for their vision and their commitment to a unified board and common vision for our schools. So all of you who would like to stop our rowing in the same direction, you just have to stand aside because we've got a lot of rowing to do.
My arms are tired.
And that concludes my report. And so we'll open up for announcements. Ms. Bugs, we'll start with you.
Oh, yes. I did the Great Schools Tour. It was really impactful. I just so happened to have my uncle along with me, so we had some really robust discussions regarding, you know, the local board, as well as what's happening at the state regarding education. We visited Rose Park, Magnet Middle, and STEM Prep, which is a charter school out by NSA where TPS used to be. And the things that we saw and the collaboration we saw happen at the end during the discussion period was very hopeful. It definitely was, because here you have a magnet school and a charter. You have some zone school parents visiting, and the discussions that we had, I wish everybody could go, and I will be forwarding those invitations along to the rest of you.
Thank you. Ms. Pierce.
Yes, this afternoon I had a really fun day over on Hillsborough Pike at the large construction site of Southern Land. It's a 18-story building that's going up, and they collaborated with the Hillsborough High School art students, and Mike McNally of Southern Land donated large canvases and paints, and the art teacher, Brianna Hammering, worked with 75 students, and they painted murals, and so it's going to be a beautiful addition to the chain link fencing that goes around commercial construction sites. So I'm hoping that other groups around the city will take Southern Land's lead and partner with our schools and just add this new aesthetic piece to a construction site. So the students got to watch the unveiling, and several were interviewed on the news. So it was a fun afternoon.
Yes, I had an opportunity to participate in the Exceptional Ed Listen and Learn on last week, and staff and some of the paraprofessionals were there, and it was a great, really good feedback from them on the professional development that they've received. They were really excited, glad to see us rowing in a great direction. The parent participation part, we only had about 5 parents. That was unfortunate, but we did get some great feedback, and I can't wait to see the written report from that experience. So thank you, Monique Felder. Dr. Felder, I'm sorry for participating in that as well.
Thank you. I too participated in the literacy voice sessions last night for our parents and teachers, and almost 40 literacy teachers and classroom teachers attended the session at Rose Park Middle School, and 17 parents attended. They were a very passionate group and gave us great feedback. As a matter of fact, they enjoyed the session so much that an hour was not enough time. So in at least one case, we went 30 minutes over, and then after we closed, they still stayed, and the discussion continued. So it was a major success and time well spent. On October the 12th, we planted a tree to signify the groundbreaking for construction of the new Maplewood High School Health Clinic, which is a benefit to our community as well as our students. Personnel from St. Thomas had so many wonderful things to say about our students at Maplewood, and I'm very excited about this partnership. And speaking of Maplewood, I don't see TJ here tonight. Is she there? But did you guys see that she was in the op-ed on Friday, I think, in the Tennessean, written by Carla Solomon. She referenced the importance of women in STEM education programs. And she suggested that jobs that require a STEM education will grow by 17% by 2018. And but more than 1.2 million of those high-paying positions will go unfilled because of lack of qualified workers. Guiding girls through traditionally male territory is something TJ Williams does very well. So I'm sorry she's not here to hear the kudos. And I'm also apologize that we talk about her so much, or I talk about her so much, but she, there's just so much to talk about with TJ Williams. We had a phenomenal teaching and learning committee meeting today with 8 board members present, and we had a robust discussion. And as a matter of fact, we only got through about half of our agenda. So we will continue that discussion at another time. On November the 2nd, we'll take a field trip to Atlanta to visit the Ron Clark Academy, and I look forward to reporting on that adventure at the next meeting. Thank you.
Ms. Vogue.
I'd just like to announce that Hillwood High School this Friday, October 28th, will be hosting the Hillwood Cluster Showcase at 5:30 p.m. It's 5:30 to 7, and then there's a football game afterwards. It is a very family-friendly event. There will be free food. Last year I went, and the chefs from our hospitality academy cooked, and it was delicious. There'll be hands-on activities and representatives there from all Hillwood Cluster schools. Students that participate and visit in each academy representative and learn more about the high school will get into the football game for free. So encourage everyone to come out and enjoy a night at Hillwood High School.
Dr. Brannon. No. Dr. Gentry.
I just want to thank Dr. Joseph for joining me on some school visits on Monday, although he tried to cut my foot off. I have a big bandage on side of my foot, if you haven't noticed. I hurt myself. Yeah. We started off at White's Creek. We went up to Jolton Elementary and down to Jones Padilla. Our day got cut short. We were joined by some observers from Harvard University that are working on a case study. So it was a really, really, really good day. Great things going on in our schools. And so for those that we had to reschedule, we will get to you in the next couple of weeks. But it was a good time, a really, really good time.
I have just a few. I wanted to say congratulations to the PE teacher, Susan Floyd, at Andrew Jackson Middle Elementary School, the PTO, and all of the wonderful volunteers who made the 25th annual Eagle Run the great success that it was. And as always, Ms. Floyd always finds a way to make me rummage through my purse looking for tissues. She always makes it very emotional. I want to say congratulations to the McGavick High School Marching Band. They competed last Saturday at the state championship in Murfreesboro, and out of 19 bands, they took third place. So congrats to the Long Blue Line at McGavick High School. And we were there for the day, and we were sitting in the shade, and it was cold. So I kind of wimped out on that thing for the last. And I just one last reminder that the class meeting, the annual class meeting, is scheduled for Sunday, November the 6th at 1 p.m. at Gaylord Opryland Hotel. We will discuss our legislative policy for the upcoming legislative session. And our next meeting is scheduled for Tuesday, November the 8th. That's Election Day. And I want all the people in here and all the viewers to be voting on that day. So barring any unforeseen circumstances, we are going to cancel that meeting and move public participation to the second meeting in November. So unless you hear otherwise, this is, you know, this is what we're going to do, because everybody needs to be voting and needs to be watching and making sure your favorite person wins at the polls. That's what I'll be doing anyway. So with no further business, Ms. Bucks?
Be there no further business. This meeting is adjourned.
Thank you.